Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the June 3rd, 2015 Town Council meeting. We will begin, as always, with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So, we have a very special event today for this Town Council meeting. We are awarding the 2015 Boston Post cane, and let me read this pronouncement. Town of Newmarket, New Hampshire, a proclamation for Evelyn Rodier LaBranche, the recipient of the Town of Newmarket's Boston Post cane 2015. Evelyn Rodier LaBranche was born in Newmarket on November 13, 1913, to Ovius and Amy Rodier. She lived at 13 New Road, Newmarket, New Hampshire. As a child, she attended St. Mary's School in Newmarket, her eighth grade classroom right here. At an early age of 17, she married Terry LaBranche of Newmarket. Evelyn had two daughters, Eleanor, who is a sister of Holy Cross living in Manchester, New Hampshire, and Lorianne LaPointe, who lives at 9 New Road in Newmarket, New Hampshire. She has two granddaughters, Michelle Butler, living in Cohasse, New York, and Lisa Parsons, living in Tilton, New Hampshire. She has four great-grandchildren, two girls, Amy and Andrea Butler, and two boys, Jack and Andrew Parsons. She is the very proud great-grandmother of her fifth-generation great-grandson, Ryan Jr. LaSasse, and great-granddaughter, Emma LaSasse, the children of Amy LaSasse of Clifton Park, New York. Evelyn Rodier LaBranche worked several years for Gallant's Silk Mill as a silk winder. Later, she was employed as a sample shoe stitcher for Sam Smith and Royce Shoe Factories in Newmarket. Upon retirement, she worked part-time for Kent and Pelzar Funeral Home. Evelyn Rodier LaBranche had several interests throughout her lifetime, especially her flower gardening, making crafts of all kinds, cooking, and entertaining many guests. She was an active member of the local Senior Citizens Club, the Women's Club, St. Mary's Church Community, and the Women's Catholic Foresters of America. The latter had a junior foresters group of girls that Evelyn worked with, planning their activities, taught them crafts, and sang for nursing home residents. Evelyn Rodier LaBranche enjoyed her circle of friends with whom she enjoyed trip-on-travel tours as well as day trips. She enjoyed belonging to a walking club, which kept her walking 3 miles a day into her 80s. Evelyn Rodier LaBranche is a very optimistic person with a great outlook on life, loves people, and needs to know what is going on around her. She believes in the importance of family life. She takes much pride in knowing she's the matriarch of a living five-generation family. She takes great pride in her children and remains connected to the extended family of nieces and nephews. Even though Evelyn is limited in sight and hearing, she says, quote, I use what I have, and that's that. I'm not going to cry over it, unquote. In her early 90s, Evelyn Rodier LaBranche decided not to give up driving. With her loss of hearing and eyesight, With her loss of hearing and eyesight, her safety was at risk, so she accepted to move to Holy Cross Health Center, where the Sisters of Holy Cross welcome their mothers and relatives. She has been in residence there since 2009. Given at the Town Council Chambers, Newmarket, New Hampshire, this third day of June in the year of our Lord, 2015. Signed, Philip Nazaro, Town Council Chairman, Terry Littlefield, Town Clerk. Evelyn, congratulations. How do you want to get?
I wanted to say.
Okay, she wants to say.
Get out of the camera's way for you here.
Okay, you can say something.
I want to say I'm very honored to receive the Boston Post cane, and I will always take very good care of it. Thank you.
That's
That's the cane.
Use it as necessary. Probably use it up here. I did know one of those canes in the next room.
It's quite a cane.
It is. Evelyn, thank you again very much for being here. Thank you all so very much. Congratulations.
Get in touch with me.
Awesome. Thanks. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you all.
Thank you so much again for being here. Congratulations.
Thank you.
As they move out, thank you so much. We'll give them a moment.
Yeah.
The elevator is open.
Yeah.
You did good.
You did good.
All right. Well, given the makeup of the five people in the audience right now, I will open public hearing at 7:14. Does anyone have something for public hearing? She's here, public hearing. Kevin.
Non-agenda item, but it's something that's been gnawing at me. And as a resident, taxpayer, 35-year employee of the town, department head, I got to get it off my chest. I'd like to bring to the attention of the town council and the taxpayers what I consider to be a serious problem we need to get a handle on as a community, or we're likely to see an issue with retention of employees in all the town departments, particularly those employees in leadership and management positions. Changes in these leadership positions are likely to affect the level and quality of services that the residents in town have come to expect. Specifically, I want to bring everyone's attention to the fact that the town has not provided pay adjustments in the last 5 years that even come close to what our neighboring community, competitor communities have provided. And whatever raises the employees have seen have been well below the cost of living rise. In 2010, the town abolished their past practice of providing periodic cost of living raises. No town employee, to my knowledge, other than union members, have received any pay increases for three consecutive years from July 2010 to July 2013. Even though their taxes, health insurance, living expenses increased like everyone else's, their pay did not. I heard it mentioned at one town meeting that the town employees were lucky to have a job. In 2013, the town created a merit pool to allow department heads and the town administrator to reward good employees based upon their job performance. Even though the merit pool has been funded in fiscal years 2013 and 2014 and 2014-2015, non-union town employees have only received one pay increase since 2010, and no employee's increase was greater than 2%. Some employees received nothing or less than 2%. The cost of living went up at least 8.8% over the same time period, no matter whose figures you use. Imagine instituting a merit pay system, then not rewarding any employees. What message does that send? The town would be better off to tell them to their face that they're not going to get a raise like they did in the first 3 years. But when no one receives a raise and there's a merit pool in place, it sends a powerful message. It means everyone's performance is not deserving of a raise, or it means that the town has no intention of spending the merit pool money on the employees. Town employees have asked repeatedly about the status of the merit raises budgeted in the current fiscal year, and we're not getting a definitive answer about when and if they're going to happen. Most employees believe that with only 27 days left in this fiscal year, it's not likely to happen. And if it does happen, it's likely to be a lot less than the cost of living increase we all are facing. By the way, we all just received the notice that our health insurance is going to go up 8% July 1. Newmarket taxpayers have approved collective bargaining agreements and pay increases for the school district and for the police department's rank and file officers during the same time period. Public Works employees, Town Hall employees, and Recreation Department employees, non-union police department supervisors, and the full-time firefighters have received one pay raise of 2% or less in the last 5 years. What kind of message are we sending them? My junior officers, covered by the collective bargaining unit, have received reasonable pay increases based upon their membership in the collective bargaining unit. It's a good thing because it slowed the revolving door we once had with police officers. Union members' pay has increased over the last 5 years, but their supervisors' pay has not. By the end of this current contract, one of my sergeants' pay will exceed his lieutenant's, even though the lieutenant has more time on the job and has significantly more responsibility. Now my non-union supervisory employees don't see much of a long-term professional future working here in Newmarket, and I can't blame them. Some of my junior officers will tell you that they don't want to get promoted here into a salaried position because they'll make less money and work more with more responsibility. Public employees get compared to workers in the private sector all the time, but even a private sector employee would turn down a promotion if it meant more responsibility and less pay. In my only personnel evaluation since becoming chief in 2005, 10 years ago, one of my goals and objectives was to work on a succession plan for my department. This goal ensures that my supervisory staff under my control receive the training and experience to run the police department in my absence and to prepare an individual or individuals to be ready to assume command upon my departure or retirement. I think I've accomplished that. The town has two excellent choices when I finally leave. But who would blame them if they decided to take that training and experience elsewhere before that happens? I know for a fact that they are looking. And for what we could pay their replacements, I'm not sure I could attract someone as qualified as they are to fill their positions from the outside. Right now, we're only 2 week notice away from losing key people in my department. The law enforcement community doesn't work in a bubble. We constantly interact with our neighboring agencies. My staff conducted a survey of 27 other law enforcement agencies with whom we compete for qualified candidates and discovered that these other communities have continued to give raises to their employees over the past 5 years. We also discovered that the compensation for our non-union employees is 10% below the median of their professional peers in the area. We found that only 8 of the 27 departments we surveyed are requiring their employees to pay as much of a share of their health insurance as the town of Newmarket requires their employees to contribute. As your police chief and department head, I've tried to play by the rules. I've never padded a budget, I've never asked for anything I didn't need, or spent money frivolously, and I've always worked with the resources that taxpayers have entrusted to me to provide the best possible police services to this town. After all, it affects my tax bill too. Newmarket PD enjoys an excellent professional reputation with our peers statewide and from the feedback I'm getting with the residents as well. I'm proud of the people that work in my department and the work they do every day that the public doesn't see. I'm concerned that all my efforts to build and maintain a professional agency are going to result in turnover because of lack of adequate fair compensation. The town government should also follow its own rules. The charter specifically says employees and department heads will be evaluated annually. My employees get evaluations, but department heads don't. And the department's own, the town's own personnel policy, issued originally in 2008 and readopted and signed by the council in 2013, specifically Article 3 says, the town administrator and town council shall be responsible for the development and maintenance of a uniform and equitable pay plan for the town, which shall consist of minimum and maximum rates of pay for each position and for such intermediate steps as deems necessary and equitable. It also says the town administrator or his designee shall conduct a study of salary levels and shall make adjustment recommendations to the town council at least every 3 years. And the town administrator, upon approval of the council, shall adopt a merit increase guidelines effective July 1 of each calendar year, subject to the funding in the appropriate budget, in the approved budget. And finally, the town council shall determine the cost of living adjustment that will be provided to each employee on an annual basis. The case can be certainly made that we as a town haven't followed our own personnel plan since 2010 and we haven't really followed our merit plan either. As a 35-year employee of the town, in one capacity or another, I'm concerned about the poor morale I see every day by employees in every department townwide. It's time to make this issue a priority. So I'm going to forward 3 personnel action reports to the town administrator. I'm requesting pay adjustments for my 3 non-union employees. They have only seen 1 pay increase in the last 5 years. I propose we take the funding for these pay increases from any remaining funds in the police department budget at the fiscal year's end. I'm doing this because it's the right thing to do to adequately compensate your employees, especially when they deserve a merit increase because they're excellent employees. I propose we make these raises retroactive to July 1st, 2014. The total amount of the raises for all 3 employees together is about $9,300. Barring no further transfers are made from my operating budget to cover shortfalls elsewhere in the town, I will make certain that I come in within the budget. The 3 employees I mentioned are my 2 lieutenants and my administrative assistant. All 3 are exemplary employees and are critical to the operation of my department on a daily basis. Combined, they have 71 years of full-time service to the town of Newmarket. Either the two lieutenants could step in and run the agency in my absence with little or no change in the level of service that the residents in Newmarket have been accustomed to over the last 10 years. Both are highly respected members of the law enforcement community in the state and could be successful working in a command position in any police agency. Their institutional knowledge of the local residents in the community cannot be replaced by an outside candidate, no matter what their professional training and background qualifications are. My administrative assistant's institutional knowledge is just as important. She understands the budget and our department's needs. She goes above and beyond every day to make sure that the administrative needs are taken care of. Since she lived in Newmarket her entire life, she's a wealth of knowledge about the residents. She's constantly looking for a way to do things more efficiently and cost effectively. She's literally saved the taxpayers thousands of dollars over the years by chasing every bargain on items we need to operate. She's a major reason I always come in under budget every year and give money back to the town. I understand that I alone cannot approve the pay increases to these employees. I don't control the checkbook. My request does nothing to rectify a similar situation that exists with all the town employees. I'm sorry I don't have the ability to correct that for them. I know great town employees in other departments that are actively looking for jobs elsewhere, and it disturbs me. My responsibility as chief to the taxpayers to make certain my valuable, experienced employees, who we've spent years providing training and developing professionally, don't leave to take their talents to another job where they'll be compensated commensurately with their responsibilities and their professional peers. It's time to end the merit pay system, which doesn't reward merit. Conduct a salary study and come up with a plan to provide the town employees with an adequate, reasonable compensation before it's too late and we're all looking at a whole bunch of new faces. Thanks for listening.
We normally wouldn't have a conversation following public comment, just because I know there's a conversation already going on in FY14. Could you please?
Sure. We did have to look at the budget. We do have the merit pool. The chief mentioned he'd have to find it in his operating budget. He won't have to. We do have the money available in the merit pool. It was held off due to the snow to make sure we had everything to cover the overages. This should be completed by midweek next week. I want to meet with department heads to see what the money that we have, what they want to give to their employees. So it is being done. And my recommendation would also be to do it retroactive to July 1st because it was nothing that the employees had done. In the future, all evaluations would be completed by August, September, and then the merit pool would divide it up that way. The other issue, he did mention he does bring a good point that there is supposed to be a pay classification program in the town. There isn't one. There has never been one. At least I can't find one in the records. And I don't know if everyone's familiar with that. It's basically you have steps for those employees not covered by a collective bargaining agreement that you have a minimum and a maximum of what an employee would be making here, and you place them in there. So that is correct as well.
I don't want to get into a long conversation now, but we had steps in the personnel policy and we got rid of them.
Yeah.
Correct?
But the one I haven't seen was my time here, but that's correct.
Back, I'm talking back.
Yeah.
2015 merit pool, because 2015, there is a merit pool for 2015.
That's correct.
When will that be?
That's the one that we're doing now. That's the one we're doing right now.
So what about 2014? There's two different merit pools we're talking about.
2014.
I'm sorry, 2015 and 2016.
2016 is the one we begin on July 1, divvy that up in the summer.
Okay.
And again, I agree. I don't want to be put in this position either. It's not fair to the employees as well. And I agree. I don't disagree at all.
He had a lot more he talked about, but I feel like I don't want to. We need to talk about it in due time. Any other public comment? See, now I'm going to close public comment at 7:28. I will now accept a motion to approve the minutes of May 20th, 2015.
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes of May 20th, 2015.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion.
Council
Levy.
A couple of just subtle changes. On page 4 of our packet, there was in the first where it says discussion, it said Vice Chair Levy stated that he viewed this as mainly a safety issue, regardless of whether there would be increased usage. It was regarding New Road. I just for the record, I was sort of making a rhetorical point, which was, I don't believe New Row is going to be widened, and right now it's fairly narrow. So I just thought I would get that on the record, because the way it reads more like I was being literal with respect to widening the road, you know, with respect to the bike path. And then on page 18, regarding the master plan, it said, excuse me, I can't help it. I'd like to thank the chief for bringing that to our attention. It's on my mind. I can't concentrate right now.
Yeah, let's try to stay on this. I know we're going to have long conversations about what the chief said. Now is not the time.
I know. I don't want to get into it. I just off my thing. Anyway, on page 18, with respect to the planning board meeting I went to Councilor Pike couldn't make it. I stated that there was a recommendation for more affordable housing, and that perhaps recommendations were being made should have backup support to the findings. So the way this reads, it implies that I was supporting more. Well, let me just read it so you see what it says. Vice Chair Levy reported at the planning board meeting on May 12th, saying that he stood in for Councilor Pike. He said that Stratford Regional Planning had provided a good explanation at the meeting, and that a lot of recommendations had been made, including support and backup for more affordable housing. That was not the intent of what I said. What I said was that there was a recommendation for more affordable housing, and that perhaps their recommendations could be made in a way that would have more backup support, particularly for Newmarket. They were very general, and that was a concern I had. I was trying to be diplomatic on some level regarding some of the work that they had done. So my way of doing that was to suggest that they back it up with, you know, something more tangible. And those were the changes I made, because the context of that wasn't right. Did that make sense? Okay.
Any other discussion? Seeing none, Mr. Minister, you vote.
Councilor Burns.
Aye.
Councilor Pickering.
Aye.
Councilor Thompson.
Aye.
Councilor Weinstein.
Abstain.
Councilor Levy.
Aye.
Councilor Mazzaro.
Aye.
Motion passes 5-0-1.
Now accept a motion to approve the non-public minutes of May 20th, 2015.
Motion to accept the non-public minutes of May 20th.
Is there a second? Motion and a second. Any discussion? Seeing no discussion, Mr. Administrator, vote.
Council Burns.
Aye.
Council Pickering.
Aye.
Council Thompson.
Aye.
Council Weinstein.
Abstain.
Council Levy.
Aye.
Council Nazaro.
Aye.
Motion passes 5-0-1.
Report of the Town Administrator.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. First, I want to bring the council's awareness about the drought that we are currently under. There's some questions on what the level we are and what the conditions are. While it may seem that odd that we're at a drought with all the snow that we received during the winter, we did not get much rain this spring to replenish our water sources. Even the storm we got this past few weeks, a few days, didn't help some, but not enough. And the water superintendent and I are monitoring the water levels of all the town wells. Currently, the town is under stage 2 water emergency. Just to remind residents, a stage 2 emergency restricts those homes and businesses that are on town water systems to when they can water their lawns. Those whose addresses end in odd numbers are able to water on odd number days only. Those whose addresses in even numbers are able to water on even number days only. Those who are on their own systems, it's only those who are on the town system. Unless something dramatically changes, pursuant to town code, we're preparing to declare a stage 3 water emergency in town. Stage 3 would restrict lawn watering to 2 days a week between the hours of 5 a.m. and 6 p.m. Even numbered addresses would be on Tuesdays and Thursdays and odds on Mondays and Wednesdays. There would be no washing of driveways, sidewalks, autos, or boats. Handheld hoses may be used for flowers and vegetable gardens plus shrubbery without hour and day restrictions. And all those ordinances are subject to a fine. We are still monitoring. It did help some this weekend with the rain, but we want to see where we end up sometime next week before we go to the next level. It's hard to believe, but if you think of it this way, every foot of snow is about an inch of water. So we got many feet of snow, but that doesn't equal to a lot of water. The next item is that I'm happy to say that Coast Route 7 will be continuing in a modified manner in town. Town Manager Exeter, the Executive Director of Coast, and I worked to establish a modified route to provide a few main items. Primarily was to have some ADA transit service in the community. This was the most requested item that we heard during the hearings. The new route would also provide the people with the ability to shop in Exeter and Stratham and get to the Exeter Hospital. It would also circle, basically what we'd be doing would be circling between Exeter and Newmarket 3 workdays a week and on Saturdays. The route would begin at 9:35 each morning and the last bus would leave Newmarket at 5:04 p.m. The Saturday route would be very similar, slight change in times. And this route would also complement Wildcat Transit to allow people to get to Dover and Portsmouth. The days of the week were announced today. They're going to be in the press tomorrow, and the service will begin on June 29th. I don't have that in front of me. I want to make sure we have the right ones. As the council may have heard, we were continuing to monitor in the City of Portsmouth, Town of Exeter's wish to establish a regional wastewater treatment facility at the Peace Trade Port. The Portsmouth staff recommended that they move the City of Portsmouth move forward with upgrading of their Pierce Island facility. They did so because they estimated that the cost to be $90 million, whereas the upgraded Peace facility would be $137.9 million. The City Council in Portsmouth approved that plan. While they're going to continue to work with Exeter to accept wastewater at Peace, for all intents and purposes, the regional option will not be going forward as part of this project. Two other items. This morning we had a regional economic development forum held by the Exeter Chamber of Commerce at the Mill Space. It was very well attended with about 70 people there. There was a panel of discussion. The main topic of discussion was how Newmarket redeveloped its downtown and the successes that we've had. The panel included myself, Mr. Chimberg, a representative of the Rockingham Economic Development Corporation, Ireland Chafee for the NCDC, as well as Peter Michu from the State Historical Department of Historical Resources. And everybody attended was very happy and impressed in what Newmarket's done. And also that a lot of the people not involved with the town commended the council for their work during the time of the construction. I just wanted to make sure that the public knew that as well, that they appreciated that and mentioned how easy it was to work in the town of Newmarket when it came to business. The final item is that tax bills will be going out shortly. And they'll be due on July 8th, and you should have them in the mail. You should receive them sometime this weekend, if not sooner. And that's all I have tonight, Mr. Chair.
Questions? I have one in that we usually get department reports, and there are no department reports.
That's the second meeting of the month.
No.
You get it once a month.
Hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Any other comments?
I think we got enough.
Yeah. Seeing none, committee reports. Does anyone have any committee reports? Stop. Or is that the second meeting of the month?
Nope. I've got a committee report. The Highway Safety Committee met about 2 or 3 weeks ago to discuss the request from Mr. LeBeau about parking in the downtown area. And it was basically to change the non-parking streets on the hill to parking during the summer months. And the committee decided that it's still, if you put on parking on those streets during the summer months, you would not be able to get a fire truck safely up the street in case of a situation like that. So they recommended not doing it this time. We are coming up with a list of parcels and other ideas to try to address some of the parking situation. But the committee acknowledged that unless there's a significant purchase of land in the downtown area, that we'll continue to see some parking issues because we just do not have the stock, except for the streets that that is needed for, especially for overnight parking.
Any other committee reports? Seeing none. Old business. Resolution 2014-15-54, auditorium equipment. Do I have a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve resolution 2014-15-54. Second.
Motion to second. Discussion. Are we getting briefs?
Actually, I can address some of this. What this is as the council is aware, that we've been trying to upgrade the systems in the auditorium for be able to have additional meetings in that area. We painted already and provided new chairs from the building maintenance capital reserve fund, and this is to upgrade the sound recording with cameras as well as this audio visual equipment in the air in the hall. Currently, whenever we have to use overhead projectors, we have to borrow it from another department and bring it in. What we're looking at is to install a permanent screen on the stage as well as an overhead projector. When I say overhead projector, I mean the LCD projectors that are connected to the computers. Basically, a similar setup that we'd have up here. The cable TV department with the IT secured 3 quotes. They are recommending to go with Access AV out of Concord, New Hampshire for a quote of $40,390. I reviewed, there were some questions and we reviewed the 3 bids. One of the questions was about labor. And if you look on the bids, the labor's similar, if not equal. And the reason why was 2 of the quotes did not include installation. So they had to receive a bid to install those. The installer indicated that they could do it at the similar price as what Access AV would do, a complete nuts to bolt install and provide the equipment. The other 2 would just provide the equipment. So I backed out the cost of the of that labor, and Access would come in at $31,755, B&H would be $32,393, and Full Compass would be $33,826. So it would be still Access would be the lower one with the labor taken out when it's just a comparison for equipment. So that's the difference on that one as well.
Questions, comments? Council Levy.
Is all this money being paid by Comcast?
It is. This is the cable franchise fees that are, when we say Comcast, yes, we charge Comcast the cable franchise fees. I just want to make sure people know this is also the part of the bill that they charge the subscribers and collect it and send it to us. But this is the, yes, this is the franchise fees. None of it's the tax dollars.
And I'm the one that was asking about the install, so just for clarification. So B&H, you know, Access is obviously local there in Concord.
Yep.
So when I looked at B&H's, which is out of New York, how did they come up with $64.55 and $21.80, which is basically the same price for install? Like,
yep.
how did they determine?
What the director of IT did, he went to an installer and asked for a price to determine what it would cost to install it. Not knowing the equipment, he asked, would it be similar to these price in this range? the installer said yes, it would be in that area, and he put that in as a placeholder. It wouldn't exceed those figures, because it's not like Access AV, who knew the equipment already and installing it, so he had to try to get an estimate with the equipment list that we had, and he asked, is it in the ballpark of this?
Okay. And they didn't have that price for the third person who, I'm just curious, the third guy that quoted?
Yes, the same thing. That he had the installer fee in there as well.
I thought that was $8,027.50. Did I miss that?
That was but Doug, you have to come up to the microphone.
That was a quote I had gotten from Great Northern, and at that point we tossed that install quote. The quote we're getting for Access AV, I went to a guy from Daniels Electric and showed him the equipment, showed him some of the equipment, showed him the downstairs, and said, how much would this cost to install? And he said, I've never seen half of this stuff, but if that's what they're quoting you, I could probably do it for the same amount to do
so
the install.
So he basically matched the price without really knowing what he was getting into.
Yeah. Okay. But I mean, he felt it's cabling, it's wiring, it's different, but okay. He could adapt.
And my last question, just with respect to that, is so all these prices, you know, B&H, because B&H is known for being pretty aggressive. So the guy in Concord didn't have any heads up as to what those prices were?
No.
Okay.
No.
Okay.
Actually, our first quote came in from Access AV. The first quote we got was Access AV. And then we went online to B&H and quoted the same stuff against them, and then quoted the same stuff against the third vendor, the same equipment list.
Oh, so hold.
We don't have a salesperson.
No, that's okay.
Yeah.
So you went online to B&H and you just looked at their pricing online.
And then talked to, called their 800 number, because yeah. You can call their 800 number and get a little bit more of a discount. Some of the stuff you run into with like a B&H is, if I need 12 70-foot cables, they don't sell 70-foot cables, they sell 100-foot cables. So I have to pay for 100-foot cables, when Access AV is just going to spool it out of a box to 70 feet, crimp connectors on it, and charge me for 70 feet. So okay, you're paying a little bit extra each time with these things you have to do.
But my question was, so B&H did apply some kind of a volume discount?
Yep.
You didn't just take the price offline?
No, they gave us, it wasn't much. It came in around, I have to look at my original numbers. It probably came down about 3%. It's not bad.
Okay.
Other questions? Councilor Weinstein.
I have a general question, not so much specific to this request, but it's relevant to a few of the requests
yep.
tonight. And it's helpful to have the balances of the funds. And I don't think we have it for this one, but you know, the CIP or the Capital Reserve Fund is mentioned.
We do. Yeah, you do.
But it's on the other
71,000.
The balances,
but
the whole plan is
So my question
oh,
is,
okay. Oh, I see what you're saying.
It's helpful to have those balances, but I'm curious if I think this has come up before. If there's a narrative available of what the plan is, or just so that we know, I have no issue with this equipment or with the police cruiser, you know, necessarily, but just so we know where that is on the schedule. Because that's what I think was missing.
Like what's coming down the road, I think.
Yeah,
exactly. You know, what other projects we have, you know, this year, next year, you know, yeah, exactly.
X, Y, Z. Yeah, I see what
you're saying. I'm going to piggyback on that.
Yep.
That just, not just to be nervous, but to say that we used to at some point see the plan.
Yep.
Right? So we could see, and it's much easier to say yes or no to something, or yes to something, if it's like, this isn't the plan, that we are, our capital reserve fund is where we expect it to be, this is like the replenishment based on the franchise fee here.
Yep.
To determine yes or no, if it's like, this is not in our plan, this is why it's more important than what's in the plan, why we should be doing it. It's, without the, how we are on or deviating from the original capital improvement plan, it's hard to, as stewards,
yep.
Or agents to expend of capital reserve funds to determine whether or not we should be actually expending. Any other comments? Councilor Thompson.
I think you start to get on it when we do the capital improvement plans and the CIP and the CIP committee. Each department head when it gets to budget season, does put forth, here's what's in our capital reserve or capital improvement, and outlines that, and that all gets folded in budget season. If I understand you guys correctly, is there a way to get a refresher of that? Is that kind of what you think would be, or what we think would be helpful now to say, okay, because all that work was done in budget season X, but where are we on the projections?
I could say from the Capital Improvement Committee, having sat on it, they turn in a plan.
Right.
So, like, it's just a document. It's like what they're going to spend each year, how much they're getting each year, mm-hmm. what they're expending each year. Mm-hmm. So the plan is out there.
What we can do is when a department comes in for withdrawal from a capital reserve fund, that will add on their page from the capital improvement plan, so you know where it is. If it's not on that page, then the department head or myself will explain why this is not on there and the reason why.
And how you're going to modify the plan moving
yeah.
forward.
Right.
Any other comments? Seeing none, Mr. Minister, the vote.
Councilor Burns.
Aye.
Councilor Pickering.
Aye.
Councilor Thompson.
Aye.
Councilor Weinstein.
Aye.
Councilor Levy.
Aye.
Councilor Nazaro.
Aye.
Motion passes 6-0.
I will accept the resolution on, or a motion on resolution 2014-15-56, purchase of Motorola APX 6500 LIVHF 100 watt digital mobile radio for police department.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second. Oh. Amy beat me to it.
Amy Burns, second. Discussion. Are we getting a brief on this?
Chief is here.
It might be easier to talk about that resolution and the one following it together because they basically are a replacement of a police cruiser. About 6 years ago, we were told by a Motorola vendor that the mobile radios in our cruisers were obsolete. They were 15 years old. They still worked, but they're 15 years old, and they're going to start running out of parts for them. They couldn't fix them if they broke. What we've been doing for the last 5 years is every time we replace a cruiser is we buy one of the new radios rather than go out and just buy, six radios and put them in the cars. We've decided that we'll try to save the parts from the radios from that we take out of the cars and stretch it out another 5 or 6 years and leave the money in the capital reserve. So this year it's time to replace a cruiser. The cruiser we're replacing has one of the obsolete radios in it. And as we've done in the last 4 or 5 years, I've tried to bring two resolutions in, one because the radios are budgeted in the CIP for the dispatch, and the cruisers are budgeted in the police vehicles. So they're kind of a package deal. We sought, for the vehicle, we got the state bid from Groponi Ford price. And I acquired 3 quotes to upfit the car with the lights and siren and computers and all the stuff that we have in it, equipment we have in it, cages. There are 3 vendors that you have in front of you. 2 of the vendors included the radio in their main quote. That would be Adamson Industries and Osby Mountain Electronics. In reviewing, the last quote I received in was from 2A Communications out of Newington. Their quote does not have the radio in it. I called them on the carpet for it, but that was after you got the quote in the package, because that's what I had at the time that we submitted the council package. And they sent me a quote for the Motorola radio, which we normally order separately directly from Motorola. So the price of the Motorola radio that they have quoted us is exactly the same price that Osby Mountain has quoted for us, which is $3,245. So that's the price of the radio rather than the $39.99. When I wrote the resolution, drafted the resolution back about 5 weeks ago, I didn't have any hard numbers, and I was trying to get the resolution started. Does that answer any questions on the radio itself?
On the radio, Councilor Levy.
Well, since he kind of wrapped up the radio and the truck is up there, or the car,
yeah,
can I
it.
Just, real quick, is the police cruiser getting a 4-wheel drive?
It's that an all-wheel drive.
So it's okay. That's
it's like the other ones you've seen. Them. Yeah.
And which company are we doing? Maybe you just answered it, but just so I'm clear, because I couldn't tell from this, which company is doing the retrofit?
Well,
because I couldn't. Did I miss it or did it?
No, I didn't. I didn't say. I didn't know what the council's wishes were. The Adamson quote is significantly higher. It's about $1,800 higher, I believe, if my math's right. The Ospie Mountain quote and the two-way quote with the radio would end up being about $250, $280 apart when all is said and done. I would like to talk to them a little bit more before I actually make the quote permanent, the assignment. Ospie Mountain did the last two cruises for us. They did an excellent job. We've had absolutely no trouble with them. We used to use two-way, and they're competitive also, and they're closer. But we did have some issues with them. That's why we went to Ospie Mountain last year, last time we bought cars.
Okay, because the two fleet was, I just made a quick annotation. Two fleet was $15,961
without the radio.
Yeah, which added. I'm sorry, 20. What was it? How
much? 3,245.
Okay. And then, give me one second. I was trying to figure out what, you know, I guess Adamson was 21,910. I don't know if that had it or not. But I guess at the end of the day, you're going to try to, when you make this decision, I'm assuming it's going to be with the company that's most competitive.
We're within $250 with the two quotes when all said and done.
Okay.
And whoever seems to be. And just to make sure that the lights that there are exactly the same and what have you, I'll go over that with each of them first before I decide which one to grab it. It may be that the higher quote by $250 is a better quote.
Okay. But thank you.
Councilor Thompson.
I just had a quick question between all of these. I realize they're aggregate and that the estimated cost for vehicle and related equipment is not to exceed $49,100, but in the first, that assumes that in the first resolution that we're looking at right now, the state bid price was
$39,998.
Well, I'm wondering if that needs to get changed.
That's just for the car.
Just the car without the, we're going to be well under what I asked for in the resolution.
Okay.
I see what you're saying. The car is $28,000. You're asking about the radio for the state.
Specifically, resolution 2014-15-56, whereas the police department seeks to replace yada 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 at a state bid price of $39.99. I understand there's a not to exceed, yep. But does that need to get changed? The $39.99 part, since I believe that the chief said it came in less than that.
Right.
Well, but he's asking for $33.26. Look at the last paragraph of the resolution.
Right.
What we are authorizing is not what the state bid says, but what the final paragraph of that resolution.
Gotcha.
Is that what you're asking?
Yep.
It was a little confusing.
Because the state bid is in there and the number that he's actually requesting is under the state bid.
I assume I'm going to get told that a resolution has to read like that.
No.
But to have the state bid in there actually demonstrates that we are coming in under what the state bid is. Councilor Burns.
Can I just ask a silly question? All right, so we have this one for the radio. And you have the other one for the cruiser, but two of the bids have the radio included, one doesn't. So if you went with the bid that doesn't, then you would use this one for the radio, is that right?
Actually, they sent me a second quote, which you don't have,
yes,
for that radio, which is the same. They're going to charge us the same prices.
It washes.
Right.
Okay. All right.
I think the reason it was a little confusing is because it was 28.
You're in the car now.
Yeah, well, I'm just saying.
Well, yeah, 57 isn't ordered the same way at all.
If you go below that, then it says whereas the total cost with a vehicle and related equipment won't exceed 49.1. So it was, that's why I asked if you mm-hmm. knew what company you were going with for the additional equipment, because when you add the additional equipment to it, then you're up to whatever it is. And that's why I didn't know if you knew which company you were going with. You've already explained that you're going to go to all three companies or two of them and figure out what they're quoting you, but that's why it was a little confusing.
So I think the question, yeah, the question that leads me to ask is, well, two. One, in your resolution on the vehicle, which I realize we're not talking about right now, but we're talking about, the state bid is the 49 that you have at the bottom there. The actual request is a 49.
It's completely the opposite way of 56 that yeah. we just talked about.
It has other equipment in it, right? The 49,100 has more equipment than just the base 28,324 for that vehicle.
It's the vehicle and the upfit.
And the upfit. Yeah, the upfit does not include the radio from the last resolution.
Right. And the lettering. The last thing is the lettering. And there's no three quotes on that. And the reason for that is it costs $400. And over the years, this company has already done up the decals, and they've done all the setup work to cut them. So for $400, we've been going back to the same outfit to letter the cars. They letter them the same way every year for us. So it's a small potatoes. But that's in there too. That's figured in there too. We're going to come in at least $4,000 on the cruiser resolution below what I'm asking, probably. And we're going to come in $750 less than what I'm asking on the radio.
Steve and Kessel.
Yeah, the reason why there's two resolutions is because you're withdrawing from two separate funds. One is for radios and one is for cars. So you have to have two separate.
But they both have that 49,100
in there. I understand that, but
an accident waiting to happen here that I'd like to see if out of the total of 49,100, I get that. If the radio one is 33,26, then the car one should be
28 and whatever it is.
But there's more equipment. The thing is that there's other equipment in the vehicle. So
then the car one should be 49,100 minus 33,26.
The 33,26 is not in that 49,100.
I understand what you're saying. On the first resolution, it mentions the total cost of the vehicle is $49,100. It sounds like that the $3,000, I got the other one up, sorry, is in that $49,100. It is not, correct?
The radio is not.
Correct. So that third fourth whereas could been removed.
Yeah.
That would, yeah.
This is...
And I'm going to be honest.
We're either going to pass something that gets a total of 49,100 times two, or we're going to... I just think this is really not...
Just procedurally, if you want to make a motion to amend this resolution to withdraw eliminate the fourth whereas, you can do that.
Who made the motion on this? Councilor Levy?
Yeah.
Would you be willing to make a friendly amendment to remove that fourth whereas?
Yeah, I don't have a problem with that. I was just going to make one small suggestion, mm-hmm. just as a side note. I don't know if it, and I have no problem doing that. It might be a little easier for us if we had the vehicle that's replacing the Crown Vic at whatever it is, boom. That's one resolution. The upgrade to the vehicle, you know, whatever needs to be done, you know, alarms, safety, you know, the grate, all that stuff, you know, two. And then if there's a radio included in that, fine. If not, so then it's all broken out, so it doesn't, you know, because that's, I was a little confused when I saw the 49,100 and whatnot, so. It's not really a criticism. It's just it would be, I think, easier if there were separate resolutions. But if it simplifies this, I have no problem making a friendly amendment to take out the fourth whereas or whatever.
Yeah.
And that will be picked up in the next resolution, I'm assuming. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I mean, I think at the end of the day, we could pass all of these and Chief is going to end up spending 38 and change or whatever it's going to be, but that's not the point. The point is we should probably do this in a more, mm-hmm. you know, segregated.
I'm going to be honest. When I submitted the resolution, I copied the previous years, because it's the same idea that we're doing, and I just interjected the numbers.
It
changed.
No, I just,
so it's the way we've been doing it in the past. If you know, I'll put it together whichever way you want.
Yeah,
we'll change every council you get. So, so who, Council Levy has a friendly amendment. So who made the second?
I did.
Because I had an Amy, I don't know.
Are you fine with making that?
I'm fine with making.
Any other discussion on the radio?
I had Amy there.
See, no other discussion on the radio, Mr. Administrator, the vote.
Councilor Burns.
Aye.
Councilor Pickering.
Aye.
Councilor Thompson.
This is to approve it as amended, correct?
Yes.
Aye.
Councilor Weinstein.
Aye.
Councilor Levy.
Aye.
Councilor Nazaro.
Aye.
Motion passes 6-0.
I mean, I'll take a motion for resolution 2014-15-57, the purchase of the Ford Police Cruiser for the police department.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second. Is there any more discussion on the police cruiser? Councilor Levy, is this older?
Oh, no, that's old.
Any other discussion on the cruiser? Seeing none, Mr. Administrator, the vote.
I'm sorry, did I have
it's
a motion
old in
a
that
second?
Crown bit.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amy, B, and Tony.
Thank you. Councilor Burns?
Aye.
Councilor Pickering?
Aye.
Councilor Thompson?
Aye.
Councilor Weinstein?
Aye.
Councilor Levy?
Aye.
Councilor Nazaro?
Aye.
Motion passes 6-0.
I will now accept the motion on resolution 2014-15-58, purchase of APC Symmetra power module to replace similar unit in the police/dispatch center. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Oh. Motion and a second. Discussion. Do we need a brief on this?
Yeah, can we just get a real quick background? What is
back during the winter, February or so, we had a power outage. And when the power outage kicked over the main power supply from PSNH to the generator, we lost the power in dispatch. In tracing it, we found that the problem was we have a battery backup system in dispatch that actually runs everything in dispatch. So it charges off of the line power and keeps the batteries charged, and the computers and all the radios, everything runs off of the batteries, so that you never have a power surge and you never have a spike that will ruin the equipment. When we lose power from the line, the generator kicks on within a couple of seconds, but there's usually a little bit of a surge. But all that does is charge the battery, so this power module is how we power the entire dispatch center. When we had the power outage, we found that it was a failure with this APC, which is American Power Conversion, Symmetra power equipment that we have in there. It's 15 years old, and mostly it's componentized. It has battery packs that we've replaced as the batteries start to go bad. We replace them a little at a time. And the battery packs that are in there are fairly new. When this whole system went and failed and we lost power, we were able to switch over within a couple of seconds and get off of that, but we still were worried about the power surge issue. We found that by replacing the power module that we were able to, rather than replace the whole unit, which was going to be $6,000 or $7,000, we replaced one part after talking to them on the phone and said, let's try that first. If that's it, your batteries are going to be good. This should fix it, the whole problem for you. So we, rather than replace the whole item, we just went out and did it. I spoke with the administrator, told me, just go ahead, we have to have it. So we did it. I paid for it out of the budget, but it's really a capital item that we would normally replace this whole power system eventually, and this is going to be a lot cheaper than $6,000 or $7,000. The cost that's in here is the exact cost of the part we purchased, and the installation was done by members of the dispatch center and Doug Poulin. They installed it after talking to them on the phone, so it was no other costs involved. So this is a single source vendor. It's the part for that system that was in there. And rather than replace the whole system, we replace one part, and it looks like it's going to be good for us.
Councilor Levy.
Yeah, it was a rhetorical question, but obviously it worked.
Worked.
Do you have surge suppressors on everything in there? I'm assuming you do. But
yeah, we do. But it's not it's really critical with the phone lines, and we've got phones are all electronic now, the computers and everything, and And so most of it is on regular power surge protectors like you have in your house, where you may lose power and your computer might die, but we can't die in there, ever. So when we do, we lose the ability to answer the phone, and we can't do that. So that's why we're on a battery system so all the time. We're always on the battery system. And the transmitter sites are also on batteries that are being charged. So if we lose power there, they'll stay on a battery for 30 minutes or so until we get the generator kicks on.
But I'm assuming your system is protected. If you had a lightning hit, what is your system, do you think, in general protected?
It's more protected than almost anything. They've told us that lightning is a scary thing and that there's a possibility that it can arc across things that, you know, you're not expecting. So they'll never give you 100% guarantee on lightning, but we're as close as you can get.
Thank you.
Ms. Weinstein.
I'm just curious, you said it's that the entire piece of equipment is 15 years old. Do you anticipate that it will last another 5 years, 10 years?
We've been replacing the battery components on it regularly, like every 4 or 5 years, one will start to die on us, and the other ones are telling us this one's overloaded, and so we've replaced those. They're $200, a few hundred dollars a piece to replace them, and we just do that in the operating budget. We've been doing that. Mm-hmm. So we've replaced all the components except the brains and of the whole thing, and that's what went this time. By replacing the brains and the fact that the batteries themselves are still in good shape, we'll just continue to pick away at them as they go. But.
Any other discussion? Seeing none, Mr. Minister, the vote.
Councilor Burns.
Aye.
Councilor Pickering.
Aye.
Councilor Thompson.
Aye.
Councilor Weinstein.
Aye.
Councilor Levy.
Aye.
Councilor Nazaro.
Aye.
Motion passes 6-0.
Thank you, Chief. Now I'll accept a resolution on resolution 2014-15-59, purchase of 2 Nitronox field units for fire rescue department.
So moved.
I have to second this one.
Motion and a second. As we start discussion, are we getting a brief on this?
Yep. Fire chief's here.
We all want to ride on the ambulance.
What it is the great state of New Hampshire added this to the protocols, 2013. And the advanced, which is the EMTs that can give IVs, get to use this equipment. We have never had the equipment because it wasn't a part of the protocols. So basically, now that it's a part of the protocols for advance, we're looking to purchase this equipment and put one on each ambulance, and it's used for pain control.
Councilor Levy.
One question. I have a little experience with nitric oxide just because visited the dentist before. Are there other, because I never really saw it as, you know, necessarily a pain killer per se. I'm assuming you this is for people, as you annotated in the documentation, for people that have serious accidents and they're in a lot of pain. And I was just curious, aren't there other I mean, you can't administer needles, or do you, or how's that all work?
This is the only drug that we can administer. We would have to wait for a paramedic to get on scene, and what the problem is typically we need to move you before they arrive.
Does this really, I mean, I don't have a problem with it. I'm just curious, does this really ameliorate the pain and cancel it out? I mean, how does it?
They wouldn't have put it in the protocols if it wasn't effective. The state of New Hampshire is allowing this now. They started it in 2013, and other departments are doing it.
Okay. My last question, and I know it, I'll probably get a couple of laughs, but I got to ask, who's going to oversee or watch this canister?
It gets locked up
because it's going to get empty.
Helium can.
Well, I'm just wondering.
It gets locked up on the ambulance.
Yeah. Okay, I had to ask.
There's this whole set of protocols.
Yeah, and there's protocols that the ambulance crew goes through. They check all
hooligans
the,
on
they
it.
Check, yeah. They check out everything to make sure levels are there.
Well, I don't think I got it. This isn't about being a hooligan. Yeah. This is about, hey,
people
that looks
giddy down there, then we'll know.
Yeah, that looks like a.
I'm not an advanced EMT, so I won't be able to use it.
Okay. I just thought I'd ask.
Councilor Thompson.
I'm going to piggyback on what Councilor Levy said. No, that is correct. It is not a painkiller. It is like other...
Like a trip to the moon.
It is. It's a hallucinogenic. Basically, it does not kill the pain, but it makes you happy enough that you kind of supposedly aren't going to notice it. And it relaxes you, and it is going to make it easier for you to manage the patients.
And then the paramedics come, and they can give you...
It's going to drop some anxiety or some anything that goes on. So it will relax, but it is not specifically a painkiller, no. My question is on page 54 of the packet on the computer, and it's in your backup, Rick. It says, how far down am I? 1, 2, 3. Fourth paragraph, the unit is available from a single source supplier. It says here that the price of the unit is $3,750. We need two. How did we get to $8,000 on the resolution?
That quote, I don't know how long it's good for. They wouldn't commit to it. So, and the other equipment. So I went to $8,000. It'll be less than $8,000, but I don't know the exact number until I can make the purchase.
Not to exceed. Should be
not to exceed. Exactly.
Okay, thank you.
Just one last real quick one. You know, Rick, just for, and I'm sure you know all this, but from a liability standpoint, and I certainly don't know enough about protocols, but it might be worth, and I'm sure the paramedics know all this, but just to ask the question, there may be some accidents or some things that people shouldn't be given something. So the reason I ask is because, someone very close to me was in the hospital and I wanted to see their pain subside because they were in a lot of pain. And the nurse came in, or the doctor, and they said, we're not really allowed to, give the person anything right now because it may mask it or whatever. And it was important for them not to do it as much as it was frustrating for me to watch. So I don't know. And so I just think for the liability of the town. No.
It doesn't affect anybody's ability to sense pain. That's what I'm saying. It calms you, but it does not.
I would just make sure that, whatever they do, it's not something that could, God forbid, exacerbate a problem.
So the question I think is, and I'm sure the answer is yes, but the question will be asked, are people going to get trained on using this?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I give you a copy of the protocol, too, and it's right in there, one of the contradictions. So,
okay. Thank you.
But, yeah, there'll be training. It gets locked up. Only the advances can get access to it, and it's all documented. There's a ton of protocol that goes behind it.
Thank you.
It's Pickering.
Surrounding towns using this already?
The full-time departments close by have paramedics, so they're using other drugs. I don't have the list of other towns using this.
Okay.
I do not know the answer to that.
Other discussion? Councilor Thompson.
Would it be appropriate to make the $8,000 a not to exceed, or just $8,000, i.e. if the bid still comes in at the expected
$7,500,
what happens to the other $500?
Withdraw $8,000. It should say not to exceed. So if it's a friendly amendment.
Who made the motion?
I had Thompson, Councilor Thompson.
I seconded it.
All right. Are you both fine with making that adjustment? Yeah. Adding not to exceed? Any other discussion? Seeing none, Mr. Minister of the Vote.
Councilor Burns.
Aye.
Councilor Pickering.
Aye.
Councilor Thompson.
Aye.
Councilor Weinstein.
Aye.
Councilor Levy.
Aye.
Councilor Nazaro.
Aye.
Motion passes 6-0.
Next resolution, which I'm sure won't get any conversation at all, 2014-15-60, agreement with Wright Pierce Engineers for construction of services for WWTP project, which is wastewater treatment plant. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Oh. Motion and a second. Discussion. Sean, you're going to lead us in a brief.
Yes. This resolution actually goes hand in hand with the next resolution.
as the town administrator said in his town report, and as an administrator report, is that the city of Portsmouth is committed to not combining the two wastewater facilities. They're going to build their one on Pierce Island. So the option that we've been waiting for to see if we could hop onto did not come to fruition. We are actually under administrative order to construct our facility to meet 8 milligrams per liter. We're actually just beginning that. It's actually May 31st is when we actually committed, but I talked to the EPA and they knew we were going to have this vote tonight. So this resolution here is actually for construction administration and oversight for the wastewater treatment facility construction, which is the next resolution. So this, because we're getting money from rural development and the New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services, they actually review and approve these construction and administration and oversight contracts, and it has been looked at and reviewed by them. It also has been reviewed by the town council, and I have
legal counsel.
Town attorney. And I have, if you have specific questions to this contract, I have actually brought Tim Vadney from Wright Pierce to answer those questions.
Questions? I recognize we've talked about this a lot. Councilor Lowry will give the requisite question.
I'll just ask one. Obviously, and it doesn't look like it's going to happen, but if there's a better option with regionalization, which clearly does not look like it's the case right now, is there a plan to address that?
I'd have to give that some more thought, how we'd go about getting out of the contract with the contractor. Suffice to say, if there was sufficient incentive to go with
the region. You mean the next resolution that we're...
Correct, yes. Yeah, they're kind of the same if we do but yes, if there's a better option that comes up and there's sufficient financial incentive, there'd be a way to find, for the town's behalf, to I was thinking more from the contractor standpoint.
So in the spirit of that, you know, something way in the back of my memory bank was at Pease when the airline went out of business, and they still went ahead with it, but I don't want to digress, with the upgrade of the downstairs there at the airport. The contractor was willing at the time. They ended up building it, but they were willing to, you know, they hadn't expended any funds or anything. Is there any kind of language? I mean, I know this is one in a million, I guess, but should there be some kind of language that protects the town in the event that the contractor,
In the event that a regional option ends up being cost effective, do we have a way to go back to the contractor and say, hey, we want to put the brakes on this?
How about the timing? What is the timing when we'll know that?
Well, that's one of the challenges. We initially came through in March, and we said we got to get this out to bid, to get good bids. Portsmouth is supposed to have numbers in about a month. We put it out to bid. We opened bids on the 16th. We had 60 days to award it from that bid opening. Since then, Portsmouth kept kind of moving the meeting date for when they were going to release their numbers, and to date they still haven't released the regional plant numbers. They've released the consolidated Portsmouth Pease numbers. So I guess I can't even speculate as to when we would be able to make the final decision, but based on all the information we've seen so far, it's kind of beyond the realm of possibility, in my opinion, of what we've seen so far.
But the City Council and City of Portsmouth voted to go with the Pierce Island plant.
Correct, yeah.
They're not moving forward with any regional plant any longer.
Yeah, so right. It's pretty much...
So it's a dead... It's
yeah.
Dead.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Balance.
Other questions? See none. Mr. Minister, the vote.
Councilor Burns.
Aye.
Councilor Pickering.
Aye.
Councilor Thompson.
Aye.
Councilor Weinstein.
Aye.
Councilor Levy.
Aye.
Councilor Nazaro.
Aye.
Motion passes 6-0.
Is there a motion for Resolution 2014-15-61, agreement with Apex Construction to construct wastewater treatment facility upgrade project?
So moved. Second.
Motion and a second. Discussion. Do we need any more brief? Or, yeah, I feel like we've got the download on it.
The lowest bid.
Council Levy.
On page 75 of our packet, last, second to last paragraph, it says, based on our review, this is you guys, Wright Pierce, of the bidding documents, past experience with Apex, and you speak highly of them, they've worked on other plans with you. In contact with Apex's bank and bonding institutions, we recommend that the town award the construction contract to Apex as the lowest responsible and responsive bidder. But this is a sentence that concerned me. However, we cannot make any guarantee that Apex will perform the work within the bid price or in accordance with the contract documents. Now, I suppose if they hit, you know, 500 feet of ledge, that would be a reasonable, I know that's an oxymoron for where they're building it, but I guess anything is possible. But what concerned me more was that last line that said, or in accordance with their contract documents. So, I mean, they've got documents that they've consummated. We've made a decision predicated on the information that they've supplied us. And you're essentially saying, well, and I'm being a little cynical, I can't really, they're really good guys, but if they don't come in at that price, we can't vouch for them. So why is that? Why are they not going to be held to that price?
Well, no, they will be held to that price, and we have a full-time inspector on site to make sure of that.
So what does that paragraph mean?
That's more in this language, it goes in every one of these letters, because they could go out of business too, you know, and that we can't really, we can't, we're not ensuring that they're going to...
But aren't they bonded?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. And so we would still have a mechanism by which we could see the project through. But we're not, it's not like a design-build project where we're a team with a contractor. We're on Newmarket's side overseeing the contractor to make sure they do it. But if they, for some reason, fail, we would have to pursue the bonding company and all those steps, too. So we're not...
Is there an additional cost associated with that?
No.
If you have to, you know, if you...
Yeah. No, that's all part of that. We would get paid from the bonding company for any additional time for that. I've had contractors go out of business on jobs before. Luckily, it's very infrequent.
Okay.
And Apex is, they do a lot of, in the wastewater industry, there's only about five or six firms that do this type of work, and they're one we see all the time.
Okay. So just to close on this, so in the outside of the event of them going out of business, and I suppose there must be some language. I didn't, you know, read every letter of the contract, but I'm assuming if they run into something that's unanticipated or, like I said, ledge or something of that nature that causes the price to spike. Other than something unforeseen like that, they are committed to that price.
Yeah, they are.
Okay.
Yeah, definitely. And that's what we're there to oversee.
I'd feel better if you didn't have that paragraph in there, but go ahead. I'm all done.
Councilor Thompson.
That was my comment, too. I'm going to back up what Gary said, coming out of construction industry or whatever. I kind of knew what you meant in that, but that whole sentence does not read correctly at all. Somebody needs to talk to somebody's attorney about that one, because you are here to to guarantee exactly that, whether it's Apex or BPEX or CPEX. that's part of this. That whole contract, that whole sentence I didn't like.
Other comments?
Well, does that mean you're going to make, is there some change that can be made or what?
Yeah, I can strike the sentence if that's what you guys, but this isn't
That's just a letter. That's not like
that's not the contract.
Yeah.
That's just their
But when it comes to the contract, I wouldn't.
Yeah. Our contract with you is standalone from this letter. This letter was just kind of let you know what we had looked into Apex and just kind of the bounds of our research into them.
I don't want to be cynical or anything, but I want to tell you if it hits the Shan, I can promise you that this letter will come out.
And this tape will come out.
And someone will say, we didn't guarantee the price. I'm just bringing, because that jumped out at me. I don't know.
Is it a time and materials contract?
No, it's a lump sum job.
Fixed price.
Yeah, that's why
I was concerned.
And the only instances in which it would be above that if there truly were unforeseen conditions, like Councilor Levy alluded to. So,
and in your experience working with Apex, have they, how many times, like, what percentage of the time do they go over the cost?
You know, I'm doing a project with them right now in Dover, and the change order percentage is within the usual norm and within the project contingency, which we have on this job as well. So we haven't had anything go.
You haven't had go over the.
Yep, not in the projects that I have.
How many projects?
For me, probably 4 or 5 over the last 15 years. For Wright Pierce, many more, but I don't have those numbers.
But just remember, this paragraph does not help us. You know, in other words, this is not written for us.
Yeah.
Meaning the
it's
town.
For Wright
this,
Pierce.
Yeah, there's nothing against, you know.
Yeah.
Let's protect Wright Pierce.
Yeah, I support, you know, Wright Pierce on this and all that, but that, I have to be honest with you, that kind of bothered me.
Okay.
I mean, if there's something unforeseen, I get it, and I think everybody here gets it. But I you know, when it went to that next level where it said within the bid price or in accordance with the contract documents, now you're sitting there going, well, wait a minute. These are the damn contract documents that they're not even guaranteeing. Yeah. You know, it didn't, I mean, I don't know how you felt about it, Sean, you know, but I didn't feel,
it's funny cause
I didn't get a great feeling of confidence
it's
reading
funny
that.
Funny because I told him he better be ready to explain that.
Sean said he does know the council because he.
But
he
you didn't
said,
tell him to take it out.
That's it. Yeah. Well, this was already in the packet and everything.
I thought I'd let him get that.
I mean, I would feel better, you know, if the language was I can't speak for the, I'm not speaking for myself. Hmm. I would feel better, you know, if there was some language in there that said, you know, barring unforeseen, you know, and you can annotate those types of things like, you know, ledge or something unforeseen that we can't anticipate. But I, when they're saying that they're not even going to support the contract documents.
So, but we're not approving the letter.
No.
We're approving the contract. So how do we remedy this? Go ahead and see.
You've already approved, technically, you've already approved what you're concerned about now because you've already authorized me to sign a contract with Wright Pierce. I can have the town attorney make sure we address this prior to me actually putting pen to paper.
I don't remember reading this before. Maybe I missed it.
No. But what this is saying, this has nothing to do with Apex.
It's everything to do with Wright Pierce.
This is saying that Wright Pierce is not going to do this. So Apex is separate. Mm-hmm. What Wright Pierce is saying is,
we already hired
Wright Pierce. But what you're voting now is to hire Apex. The problem you're having is Wright Pierce isn't guaranteeing anything, not Apex.
Right. Right.
However, you've already authorized me to sign with Wright Pierce.
In the last resolution.
And what I'm saying is, before I sign, this will be addressed. And I'll have the town attorney also review this to make sure it's addressed before it's signed.
Can you follow up with us on that?
And that's why we're saying it also on public.
Yeah, and this is boilerplate language we put in these.
Yep.
I'm willing to strike that sentence entirely and reissue the letter if that. I mean, it really, I think we're all on the same page, or I could amend it as you suggested to say, barring any unforeseen accounting for unforeseen conditions kind of thing, or some wording that, mm-hmm. I think we all understand the intent, it's just
because
the
wording is. Guarantee it. You are, in fact, guaranteeing barring unforeseen circumstances. You're ensuring.
No, the agreement is between the town and Apex.
Right.
They are not guaranteeing what Apex does.
Right.
What they're saying is they've checked their references. They're saying the references are good, but if Apex screws up, they're not liable for that. They've just checked their references, and it's the same thing. If we check the references, we could get the same thing, but we wouldn't be liable.
A very concise summation of it.
Yeah. So what this is just like any other contract we sign with Apex. We'd sign with a contract. With the only difference here is a third party did the reference review.
Yeah, and they're going one level beyond, in all fairness, Steve, because they've worked with them before. They're vouching for them. You know, we're predicating this decision to a great extent on Wright Pierce, who's our expert in the field, who's saying these people are the right people. Mm-hmm. No pun intended. So, I mean, that I just think that, you know, that's the only one that bothered me.
Yep.
So, I think I would feel better if it wasn't written that way.
Before I sign a contract with Wright Pierce, we'll make sure that there's a agreement that addresses this, and we'll put a copy in the council's mailbox.
I mean, if anything, God forbid, ever happened, you know, everybody gets sued.
Yep.
I think you know, you've just been through all that stuff. So, I mean, everybody gets a letter.
Yep.
But I think the reality is, you know, if we see this, because I wanted to bring it up before when we were voting on the last, you know.
The last, that would have been actually a better time.
Well, I know, but I didn't want to jump. I didn't want to jump ahead because then I'd be jumping ahead. So anyway, you get the point. I think if you can help us, that would be great.
Any other comments on this? Seeing none, Mr. Minister of the Vote.
Councilor Burns.
Aye.
Councilor Pickering.
Aye.
Councilor Thompson.
Aye.
Councilor Weinstein.
Aye.
Councilor Levy.
Aye.
Councilor Nazaro.
Aye.
Motion passes 6-0.
Steve, just one, and that is predicated on the what
he's
we just discussed.
Okay.
You've authorized me to sign. I won't sign until I have that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is there a motion on resolution 2014-15-62, transferring funds from the downtown TIF Capital Reserve Fund?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion.
I want him to explain it again.
I can. Yeah.
Come on, man.
For the new councilors, I mean,
know that we've heard this.
It would probably help the old councilors understand
it
too.
All right, this is an annual resolution that we do. It's a housekeeping one. Back in 2011, town meeting set aside some funds to pay for the debt service relating to the downtown infrastructure improvements. It's just that the debt service, or the capital reserve fund that the funds are sitting in, are called the downtown TIF capital reserve fund, even though the downtown TIF has been closed. Okay, we are asking for two withdrawals from the capital reserve fund. The first one for $11,636.43 for interest, and $88,968.75 for interest and principal in January. Any questions,
Councilor Levy?
And
Councilor Thompson.
Just so I make sure I recollect it, and this is really more of a paper transfer. There's no money actually coming out, or is there?
The money actually comes out of a capital reserve fund. We have I think it's just under $1 million now.
Yeah.
And it comes out of a capital reserve fund.
And goes
to, I believe it's U.S. Bank.
It's the bond bank.
The bank that is representing the New Hampshire Bond Bank. U.S. Bank is the bank, like we have TD Bank.
The reason I was confused is because I remember we were doing an accounting.
I think you're thinking about the fire department.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Where the fire, this was when we closed the reserve. We closed the TIF.
Yeah, I thought it had to do with the TIF.
No.
Remember there was an...
You're thinking of the Public Works facility one.
I apologize. Oh, yeah. Right.
We are looking at... The reason why this one still exists is because there is no provision in the bond documents to allow us to pay the bond off early. So we have to wait until the life of the bond, even though we have the money sitting there, we have to wait till the end of the life of the bond. So annually we have to request a withdrawal.
Okay. Is that money earning a little bit of interest?
A little interest.
That's the key word.
A very little interest.
Thank you.
Councilor Thompson.
That addresses my questions. Thank you.
Any other questions? Seeing none, Mr. Minister of the Vote.
Councilor Burns.
Aye.
Councilor Pickering.
Aye.
Councilor Thompson.
Aye.
Councilor Weinstein.
Aye.
Councilor Levy.
Aye.
Councilor Nazaro.
Aye.
Motion passes 6-0.
Is there a motion for resolution 2014-15-63 relating to fiscal year 2015 year-end budget transfers?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Want to talk us through these?
Okay. About a month ago, I prepared an estimate in where we think we're going to land for year-end and determined that there are certain areas of the budget that we just need to cover, essentially. For example, if you go to the bottom of the Excel spreadsheet that I provided, you'll see that there is vehicle costs, there's fire, part-time salaries, because we had significant calls. If you move up, there's some town hall maintenance for $24,000. If you move up, there's $12,000 or $13,000 for economic development. And then there's just a few others. Health insurance is over what we budgeted for, $33,000. And and we've asked departments to contribute towards these overages. And you'll find that some money came from the finance department, much more came from the town clerk, a lion's share came from the welfare department, and the police department also contributed $15,000 towards this. Now, this plan also preserved the merit pool, and that's the largest thing that we tried to protect.
Councilor Thompson.
Subtotal in the spreadsheet?
Sorry?
No subtotal on the spreadsheet?
No, well, the subtotal has to equal zero. What you transfer from one line has to go to another line.
And again, this I know,
yeah.
But I didn't want anybody to make an assumption. It has to be zero, zero.
Yes.
So that just to have a total sum, we're moving X dollars from here and the same dollars into here and here and here and here. I get that. The resolution then does not have to have any dollar amount, or should the resolution then have said for a net sum of $0 or something? Again, I'm clear on this, yeah. But I'm not sure that
what you're actually what you're authorizing is not. I understand what you're saying. You want to know the total of the transfers.
Yeah, but it's just one more piece. Again, yeah. I'm fairly used to looking at it. I know that it's a zero to zero, and it's a net zero. I understand where you're going, Matt, but I thought it would might
I can be break it out so it's from and through. Okay.
Councilor Levy.
And to that point, when you do that reconciliation, could we all be given a copy of that when we go into the budget?
Sure. Yes.
Because that would
It's included in the budget document that we present.
No, I know it is. It is. It's buried.
To be synopsized.
It's buried in that document, and we end up looking at lines and asking questions. And I'm not saying
No, absolutely. And that's actually a discussion.
Yeah.
The finance director and I have been having is
separate sheet. Let me just get just make sure everybody's okay with it. It'd be nice to have a breakdown of every department that needed more money. And how much more, and all the transfers, and then all the ones that you took from that may not have needed as much money, so it helps us when we're doing the budget. I think that would be a good tool.
Yeah, and absolutely, because one of the things that you'll see is, and we get, it's not frustration, but we have to explain that, okay, look, you had the budget of 40,000, you spent exactly 40,000. Well, actually, we spent $60,000, but we transferred X amount to offset it. Right. So that's what we—that's what you want to make sure that
this will
you
be
see.
Helpful.
Yeah, yep. It would be much easier.
And we've actually discussed whether or not we should. This is the accounting thing. This is the legal accounting thing we need to do.
Mm-hmm.
Philosophically, you want to see the opposite. You want to see over expended.
But that other piece.
Yep. Absolutely.
That's why we do go by actuals.
Yep.
What did we actually spend? Was the budget on or wasn't it?
Right. And that's where you go.
Yeah.
So you know what we want.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other comments? Seeing none, Mr. Minister.
Councilor Burns.
Aye.
Councilor Pickering.
Aye.
Councilor Thompson.
Aye.
Councilor Weinstein.
Aye.
Councilor Levy.
Aye.
Councilor Nazaro.
Aye.
Motion passes 6-0.
Resolutions in the 18th reading. There are town council rules. Thank you, Matt.
Can we do it tonight, even though Dale isn't here?
We could do it tonight, just to get it over with. But we only have two resolutions next time.
Okay, so
great.
Let's do it then. Let's skip it. I don't care.
And I just want to clarify one thing, and I know the chair and I talked about this today. There is no changes between the rules that
there's some administrative stuff.
But what I'm saying is there were no changes between the sets of rules that we're operating under.
Yeah.
I just don't want anybody to think that we're operating under new rules.
No, but there are some issues in here that just literally don't make sense when I read it.
Again, but I just want to clarify that we're not proposing any changes.
All right, so we're going to hold on that one.
Yeah,
then.
I mean, we're already here. We only have two resolutions next year.
We'll do this at Christmas.
Yeah. I want to see how long we can let this go. Maybe he'll reach Fox Hollow level.
In the 18th reading.
Is
that it?
Hey. New business and correspondence. We have a couple things that we have to deal with there. If we can get to it. I will take a motion to accept the resignation of Victoria Brown from Cemetery Trustees.
Make a motion to accept the resignation of Victoria Brown from the Cemetery Trustees.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion?
Just that's with regret, correct?
Absolutely.
Clearly.
We regretfully, she's moved to Dover.
Yep.
She has served loyally, and we thank her for her service if she gets this in Dover. Mr. Minister of the Vote.
Councilor Burns.
Aye.
Councilor Pickering.
Aye.
Councilor Thompson.
Aye.
Councilor Weinstein.
Aye.
Councilor Levy.
Aye.
Councilor Nazaro.
Aye.
Motion passes 6-0.
We have two resolutions in the first reading. Resolution 2014-15-64, the purchase of a Chevrolet pickup truck for Public Works. Whereas the Highway Department needs to replace its 1999 Dodge Dakota half-ton pickup truck, and whereas the department obtained a quote from Colonial Chevrolet, who is on the state's bid list, and whereas the price of the 2015 Chevrolet Silverado half-ton pickup truck is $20,020, and whereas the Public Works Capital Reserve Fund has a balance of $488,070, as of March 31st, 2015, now therefore be it resolved that the Newmarket Town Council does hereby authorize the Town Administrator to purchase the 2015 Chevrolet Silverado half-ton pickup truck from Colonial Chevrolet and enter in any related contracts for a price not to exceed $20,020. First reading June 3rd, 2015, and as we discussed earlier today,
yes,
the full capital improvement
yep.
plan for them. And Resolution 2014-15-65, purchase of Mahindra 81538 HST tractor for Public Works. Whereas the Highway Department needs to replace its Club Cadet 7305 tractor, and whereas the department obtains quotes from Chappelle Tractors and John Deere, and whereas the price of the least expensive tractor, a 2015 Mahindra 1538 HST tractor, is $28,500, and whereas the Public Works Capital Reserve Fund has a balance of $488,070, as of March 31st, 2015, now therefore be it resolved that the Newmarket Town Council does hereby authorize the Town Administrator to purchase the 2015 Mahindra 1538 HST tractor from Chappelle Tractor and enter into any related contracts for a price not to exceed $28,500. First reading June 23rd, 2015. Correspondence to councilors or comments, closing comments by councilors, either. Councilor Thompson and Weinstein.
Just a quick comment on the last Mahindra tractor. I know it's the first reading, but we will have backup. And my question also is, just for clarification, on when it's state bid, like police vehicle, it's state bid, or any piece of equipment that's state bid, do we have to get three quotes?
No.
It's only one.
Correct.
The Mahindra tractor is not a state bid, is that correct?
That's correct.
And it says we've gotten two quotes.
That when
I we'll trust we will address that.
We will
that.
Talk about so, this.
Yep.
Yep. That'll
and
do
I
it.
I highly encourage you, if you have questions offline, to talk to the administrator. Like before the meeting, even if you want to. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, and this is my meeting night, and it's comments and questions, and I appreciate being able to do that.
Oh, no, absolutely. Totally. Councillor Weinstein.
I have a couple things. On May 16th, the Newmarket Solutions Group had a roadside cleanup, and I wanted to report back on that. We picked up 64 bags of trash alongside the roads. We easily could have doubled that, or probably tripled or quadrupled that number. It's disgusting, the amount of trash alongside our roads. But the real reason I want to bring it up is because I want the public to be aware that it's really incredibly easy to make something like this happen for your civic group or just your family. Anybody who wants to make a difference can do that really easily. Rick Malasky was incredibly helpful. The DPW was incredibly helpful. They're the ones who picked up the bags the next, you know, on Monday. Definitely thank the both of them, and also the Conservation Commission, because we had a picnic at Shanda Park afterwards, so I wanted to publicly thank them as well for allowing us to do that. So there's that, and then I also wanted to say that I appreciated Chief Sears' comments tonight. I know that we said we'll have a conversation about that. I'd like to have a plan for how we're going to address those concerns. And then lastly, where we have a couple more resolutions in the first reading for big purchases, if we could get that CIP narrative, a plan, that would be really helpful too. Thank you.
Councilor Pickering.
When I last sat here on this council in 2013, We were talking and had been talking for quite some time about what to do about the interim finance director. Did I miss anything last year and we hired this guy as our finance director? Or we still need to make a decision. Yeah,
we're keeping it as a contract service at this time because it's...
One, it's more cost effective. We did go out for a part-time finance director and we didn't receive... we didn't get qualified candidates. So at this point in time, it's cost effective to have a contracted position.
Any other comments? I just want to echo that. I think Chief Zier's comments were, you know, Councilor Levy and Councilor Weinstein both mentioned it, were just, I think, important to hear from him, what he said today. And I echo that. I mean, we don't have a lot on the next agenda. I don't know if we want to talk about if there's enough time to come together with, to come up with some of the stuff he was talking about, or whether it's going to take a couple of meetings. But I'd rather, obviously, swiftly matters, but right, I think.
Correct.
Is the most important thing.
Yep. So,
any other comments? We'll entertain a motion to adjourn. Is there a second?
Second.
We are adjourned.